So let's just talk real quick now. The timeline I'm going to give you to start out with, we're just going to work within kind of the timeline within the text itself. That is, we're not talking about actual historical dates necessarily. I mean, if you're to go by the dating of things in the Bible, this is when it happened. We'll get into the historicity later. But just to understand the text as the text. So if we're going through the Bible, and I'm going to skip over for right now. We're going to come back to the creation stuff in a little bit. But I'm going to skip over those opening chapters of Genesis, because I think in our conversations with theists, we get really bogged down there. And not that there isn't good stuff there to talk about, but like there's so much more out there. I mean, the Bible is such a mess all over the place. Why just, you know, get stuck in the first few chapters? Well, one reason we get stuck in the first few chapters is because that's as far as most people go, including believers. I mean, if you pay attention tonight, if you know, even a lot of you know are going to know this stuff already, but if you pay attention to the timeline and what we talk about tonight, you're going to know more about the Bible than like 98% of all churchgoers. And that's not an exaggeration. I mean, that's the dirty little secret of Christianity is nobody reads the Bible except for your like two verses in your morning devotional taken out of context that are assuring you that God has a special day planned for you. Aside from that, people don't really read the Bible. So I'm going to skip over the... And part of the reason I want to skip over those opening chapters of Genesis is that's not really where the meat of the story begins. It's kind of, to me, it's almost peripheral. And where the meat of the story begins is about 1800 BC. And again, the dates, all the dates I'm giving tonight, Old Testament and New Testament, are rough estimates, okay? Give or take 50 to 100 years. Okay, and this is just ballpark figures. So, 1800 BC in Genesis chapter 12 is really where the story begins. Adam, Noah, to me they're kind of superfluous. But this is the beginning of it all with the call of Abraham in the book of Genesis. He's a, at the time that the Lord calls him, he's living in Mesopotamia and God comes to him late at life. Is this okay to stand over here, Vic? Is that... Vic has very tight boundaries for me tonight, so I gotta watch where I roam. And the Lord comes to this idol worshiping pagan in Mesopotamia and says, follow me and I'm gonna make a new people out of you. This is the beginning of the story of Israel, is really with Abraham. And the Lord makes three big promises to Abraham, and it's important to know these promises because these unfold over the rest of the Bible. The first big promise is the promise of land. I'm going to give you a piece of real estate that's going to be yours in perpetuity. Next, he's going to say, I'm going to make you very fertile. You're going to have lots and lots of offspring. Even though Abraham and Sarah are very old and they're infertile, they're going to have a lot of offspring. And then finally, he says, you're going to be a blessing to the nations, and through you, all the blessings, all the nations of the world will bless themselves. So he will be, so Abraham at this point, 75 years old, told to pick up everything, move to a piece of undisclosed real estate, procreate, and at some point, all of humanity is going to bless themselves through your name. Those are the big three. Now, it's important to remember that the promises that God makes to Abraham are unconditional. It is not conditional upon any commandment whatsoever. It's not conditional upon behavior, like we get to Moses later. There's all these rules, right? God gives one commandment, one like ritual commandment to Abraham, and from the time of Abraham to the time of Moses, which is going to be like 450 years later, this is the only commandment that God's going to give to his people. For four centuries, no commandments except one ritual commandment, which was to what? Slice off the foreskin on your manhood.
God.
That's it. Circumcision. That's it. So there's no ritual behavioral content to Old Testament religion, really, for the entire book of Genesis until we get to Exodus. Oh, by the way, okay, so Genesis Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy are the first five books of the Bible. They are also called the what?
Torah,
which is Hebrew for instruction, teaching, law, commandment. It's one of these all-encompassing words like aloha. Torah means a lot of stuff, like shalom. So to call the Torah, what's another word? What's the Greek word for the Torah?
Is that the Pentateuch?
The Pentateuch, the five scrolls, the five books. Traditionally attributed the authorship of these five books to Moses, except nobody except all the evangelicals in the world believe that anymore. So this is what we call the time of the patriarchs, Abraham's son Isaac, who God strangely shows his love to by almost killing him. And then we have Jacob, who gets a second name, Israel. And then, of course, Jacob's 12 sons become the 12 what of Israel? 12 tribes of Israel. And then, of course, his favorite son being Joseph. And then, so the time of the patriarchs is pretty much Genesis. I should really start looking at my notes. And then 12, so this is it. And then we don't, then from the end of Genesis to the beginning of Exodus is a 450-year gap. I think a lot of Christians don't realize this when they're reading the Bible, reading through Genesis, and then, chapter 2, Exodus. No, 450-year gap where there's nothing. And then we end up, and if you want to find out how they end up in Egypt, read the book. 1250 BC, now they're in Egypt, they've been slaves, never mind the fact that there's no Egyptian record of any large group of Hebrew slaves. 1250 BC gets us to the beginning of the book of Exodus, the time of Charlton Heston, I mean Moses. And this is where the plot really thickens. Moses talks to let me go back to Abraham just for a second. I'm not a linear thinker, so just, you're going to have to deal with it. Okay, we're going to bounce around. I want to read to you the boundaries of the land that the Lord promised Abraham, and tell me what you think about these boundaries. Okay, this is from Genesis. Fewer people brought their Bibles this week. I wonder what that's about. The last crowd, everybody had a Bible, which kind of scared me. If you have a Bible, it's the Genesis 15. The Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying to your descendants, now listen to the boundaries of the land. To your descendants, I give this land from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. The land of the Kenites, the Kenizzites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, Rephaim, the Aramites, the Canaanites, the Jebusites, etc. But I guess the important part there is from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river of Euphrates. Does that sound anything at all like the current boundaries of the state of Israel? No. And yet, and I'm not getting political here. Well, sort of, I guess. I think as a free thinker, one could make a rational case for supporting Israel. I'm not getting into it, should Israel exist or not, as one of the few democracies in the league. I think you can have a rational, secular discussion about Israel, but the fact of the matter is, in this country, that's almost impossible, because a lot of people outside these walls right now think that this deal between Abraham and the Lord really happened. And that God gave them this land, not just the current boundaries of Israel, but stretching to the Euphrates. What would happen if under divine mandate, ultranationalist Jews decided that they wanted to expand the state of Israel to the biblical grant given to them? What do you think?
Armageddon.
Crazy. Yeah, exactly. Armageddon. Yeah. And of course, some people are hoping for Armageddon.
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, when we get to the commandments, remind me to tell you about the Numbers 19 red heifer. Okay.
Mike, which version of the Bible are you reading from?
This is for, this is the New Revised Standard Version.
Okay.
Yeah. In a little bit, we're going to get into translation issues. Yeah. This is probably, as far as I'm concerned, one of your more accurate translations out there, with less of a theological agenda than many other. Most translations have some kind of agenda. Oh, there's my magic eraser that they got me. Okay. I'm going to move Moses up there for a second. We got stuff to talk about with him. So, okay, well, you have seen the movie. I was kind of only half joking about Charlton Heston because that's been like the primary source of America's biblical knowledge for a few years.
I mean, really, hasn't it?
Yeah.
You know?
Charlton Heston is the man.
He is. Yeah.
Yeah. He looks like Moses.
Yeah.
Whatever Moses looked like.
Carol Heston.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So Moses, and if you did see the movie, you saw him talking to a burning bush, and the burning bush says the voice. No, he says to the voice in the burning bush, "Who should I say?" Send me to my people. And the voice answers with four Hebrew characters. And if there are any Hebrew readers here tonight, I'm sorry for butchering it. It looks like that. And it's like YH, that's really like a VH, from which we get what word?
Yahweh.
Hebrew is. Wait. Hebrew is not written with vowels. It's all consonants. And so you have to kind of infer the vowels. And it's usually pretty easy to figure out where the vowels go. When the King James Bible was put together, folks didn't know Hebrew all that well, or at least the folks translating the King James Bible, which to a lot of Christians is the Word of God. And the English in the King James Bible was 50 years out of date in 1611 when it was published. It was already antiquated English. Anyway, so why would Joseph Smith copy the, you know, style of King James English, which was already antiquated in 1611? Oh, well. Okay, so, but anyway, when the King James Bible was translated, they didn't know the rules of Hebrew vowels that much, and they came up with this word, Jehovah, which Jews laugh at, because there is no way on earth you could get this pronunciation Jehovah from those four letters. So, like, if you run into a Jehovah's Witness, ask him about that next time they come to your door. Hey, like, Jehovah doesn't even, like, exist, not even in the Bible. So Jehovah's bogus, just I'll let you know that. Yahweh, now here again, no one would ever pronounce this. When anyone here grew up in the Jewish faith? Okay, so when you're reading from the Torah and you get, I won't put you on the spot, I won't ask you. When you're reading from the Torah and you get to those four sacred letters, you don't say Yahweh. You say Adonai, which means my Lord. So, because these are the four, you can't say these words, okay? Remember from the Holy Grail, the knights who say me? Yeah. When they say that, don't say it. Okay, that's, if you tried to say that, it's like that. That's where Monty Python got that from. Okay, so the four sacred letters from the bush, which can translate, I am who I am, I will be who I will be. But this is why Christians like to claim that when you get to the Gospel of John and Jesus is running around saying, I am all over the place, that he's equating himself with God. Okay, well, it's more bogus stuff. Okay, so Moses receives from God now for the first time in the history of their relationship with the Lord. Oh, that's, by the way, anytime you see the word the Lord in your English Bible, any English Bible, it's a translation of this word. If you see the word God, does anyone know what it's a translation of in Hebrew?
Elohim.
Elohim. Which is plural, which literally means gods. We'll get into that later, maybe. Because they weren't originally monotheistic. They were polytheistic way back then. So, okay, so when Moses comes along, God gives him on the mountain, like you saw in the movie, a bunch of commandments. How many commandments? It's a trick question.
15.
How many?
15.
No, more.
Too many.
More.
Too many.
Too many. 613 commandments is the official rabbinical count. That is the number that's been the number for like ever. Am I right? Now I'm nervous because Georgia's got the whole Jewish background thing on. Is that okay? I didn't know that. But you know, Adonai is pretty good. 613 commandments. Because if you read the first version of the Ten Commandments, comes in Exodus 20. There's a second version in the book of Deuteronomy. Because what they did was, the rabbis went through and counted every single time in the whole Torah, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. In the whole Torah, they went through and literally counted every time God commanded them to do something. And the commands in the, so not just what's given on Sinai, but there are more than 10 given at Sinai, but there's, but they just, so if you read through, where Moses gets the Ten Commandments, and then he gets into some laws concerning worship. I mean, this is like right after that section. And then the chapter immediately following Exodus 20 begins like this. These are the ordinances that you shall set before them. This is God speaking to Moses. When you buy a male Hebrew slave, he shall serve 6 years, but in the seventh year he shall go out a free person without debt. If he comes in single, he shall go out single. If he comes in married, then his wife shall go out with him. If his master gives him a wife, and she bears him sons or daughters, the wife and her children shall be her master's, and he shall go out. But now, what's ironic about this? They just left slavery in Egypt. And the very first commandments after the Ten Commandments that God gives them is all about how to have slaves. That's crazy. Oh, I gotta read you this one. Well, you've probably heard this one before. Oh, yeah, this is awful. But, now, bear in mind, we're still in the category of Hebrew slaves, not foreign slaves. They get different treatment. But if the slave declares, I love my master, my wife, and my children, and I will not go out a free person, then his master shall bring him before God. He shall be brought to the door or the doorpost, and his master shall pierce his ear with an awl, and he shall serve him for life.
Wow.
Jesus. When a man sells his daughter as a slave, she shall not go out as the male slaves do. Thanks be to God. It goes on and on. Okay. It's really a hoot. I mean, read through some of this stuff. You'll hear about how people with men with crushed testicles are not allowed to approach the altar. Which makes you wonder, was that a big problem back then? If so, why? know? So, a lot of stuff. Does that make sense? That every time something is commanded, it's counted as a commandment because it comes from the mouth of God. And by the time they ended up counting them all, 613.
In the Torah?
In the Torah. Yes. In fact, after the last session we had, Andrew Brown, I believe, posted on the AHA Facebook discussion about, he posted a list that he found online of the 613 commandments. Okay, so this is where they get all the commandments that they get all fixated on forever and ever. Next, then about 1300 after they wander, and bear in mind, while they're wandering in the wilderness, no shred of archaeological evidence, and then they have turned up every likely spot in the Sinai Peninsula. No remains of any campfires, campgrounds, battles, anything, you know, tent stakes, nothing that you would expect having hundreds of thousands of people wandering around in the wilderness for 40 years. Most modern, they're like the top modern archaeologists in Israel today don't think it ever happened. Do not think that there was even a large chunk of Israelites in slavery in Egypt at all. Okay, so but if you read the book in 1300 BC, Joshua conquers the promised land. Moses is not allowed to enter the promised land. Why? You remember that one? Because during the 40 years of wilderness wandering, the people got thirsty in the desert and they complained to Moses for water. God said, please give them water. God says, okay, well, here's this rock. You can draw water out of the rock. And when Moses draws water out of the rock, he hits the rock with his staff. And that kind of makes sense because the staff have been kind of effective in other situations, like turning into the snake and everything else. And then God gets mad at Moses first because he said, I didn't tell you to strike the rock with your staff. And because of that minor infraction, Moses, the commander-in-chief of the Israelites, is made to die on the other side of the Jordan, not allowed to enter the promised land. Who would want to work for a guy like that? Okay. Joshua is followed by Judges. Okay. In the book of Joshua, they have a quick, decisive, easy victory over that's the other problem. When God gave Abraham this piece of real estate, there were actually people living there already. And so in Joshua, they clear them out and, you know, kind of the God-mandated genocide. But when you get to the book of Judges, which is right after Joshua, you get kind of a different picture. It's like they apparently weren't that thorough in their victory in taking the land. And then, and this is a big one, remember, 1000 BC is where we get to King David. And I hope to get back to him in a little bit, but he is kind of the focal point of the Old Testament, so it's good to remember. David lives, it's easy to remember, David's 1,000 years before Jesus. One big reason David is important is that in 2 Samuel chapter 7, during this time they don't have any kings. We can get back to that if we need to later. They're a tribal confederation, no kings. When you get to King David in 2 Samuel chapter 7, speaking through the prophet Nathan, the Lord tells David unconditionally that I'm going to make a great house out of you and there'll never lack anyone to sit on your throne. There will always be a descendant of David on the throne of Israel. Now, why is that so important when you get up to the New Testament? Because Jesus is also called the son of whom?
David.
They, Christians see Jesus as a fulfillment of God's promise to David that there would never lack a descendant to sit on his throne. David's a wonderful guy on so many levels. He has a really messed up family life. He has four sons in line for the throne. His oldest son, Amnon, rapes his half-sister Tamar. When Tamar's brother, David's second son, Absalom, finds out, he murders Amnon in revenge. And then Absalom rebels against his father and starts a civil war. And Absalom almost successfully dethrones David, but then Absalom is killed in battle, leaving Adonijah next on the throne. But David's youngest son, Solomon, kills Adonijah to take the throne. That's just one family. Solomon is the son of whom, by the way? David and, anyone know? Bathsheba, the woman who David saw bathing naked on her, well, I guess bathing naked is a redundancy, on her rooftop, and then he has her husband conveniently killed in battle. So it's just a little, I swear, parts of The Godfather came from the life of David. I really do. There's this David's death scene. You can see it in the First Kings, which comes after Second Samuel. David's death scene, and he's lying, and he gives this wonderful, beautiful deathbed speech about being to his son Solomon, about being a good king, be faithful to the Lord, and all this. And then after he finishes this big, beautiful speech, he says, oh, you remember that guy Shimei who cursed me like 30 years ago? And at the time I said it was no big deal and just to let it go. I want you to kill him before I die. And then remember that other guy, Joab, one of my generals, I want him dead too. I mean, it's great. It's just like The Godfather. Okay. So the next big biblical dates, we got to buzz through this.
although I really don't care about time anymore.
Next big biblical date you need to know is that in 7, so up here we'll have 1000, that's still David. In 722 BC, I'm going to back up before that. About 930 or so, the kingdom splits into north and south, never to be united again. The northern kingdom is called what? Israel. The southern kingdom is called
Judah.
The descendants of David will sit on the throne of Judah. In 722 BC, Israel will come to an end because the Assyrian Empire will capture Israel. They won't go as far as Judah. Oh, the capital of Judah is Jerusalem. This is where you've heard the phrase the lost tribes of Israel. That's a reference to all the tribes who comprise the northern kingdom. Because the southern kingdom was only comprised of the tribe of Judah, the largest tribe both in population and geography. Now this is the point where we're getting into like real history. Stuff that's been verified by sources outside the Bible. So in 722 BC, we know for a fact that Israel ceases to exist. Judah, and then a lot of these people from the north came south, and in a little bit we'll talk about why that's important and how the Bible came together. And then in 587 BC, Judah is going to cease to exist because one empire is going to take them over. Babylon. 587 BC, Babylon's going to come in, put down a rebellion. They are going to destroy the temple of Yahweh, stone by stone. They're going to haul off the brightest the upper crust, the academes, the technicians, the engineers, all the, the creme de la creme of Jerusalem gets hauled off into exile, into Babylon. Has anyone been to Berlin to the Pergamon Museum? There you can actually, next time you're in Berlin, go to the Pergamon Museum. It's an easy walk from the Brandenburg Gate, and you can walk through the actual Ishtar gates, the gates of Babylon that got taken down and then put up again in Berlin. And they got put down in the basement during the war, and they brought up. I mean, it was miraculously they kind of preserved it. It's still kind of stunning that those were the actual gates that the exiles from Jerusalem walked through. And then about 539 BC, the exile is over because Persia takes over the Babylonian Empire, and then Persia becomes the big dog on the block for the next couple centuries. And they start allowing the Jews who want to come back to Jerusalem. But a lot of them stay put in Babylon. And there's going to be a significant Jewish population in Babylon for many centuries, well up into the time of Jesus and afterwards. In 515 BC, they're going to rededicate the second temple. It's one of the first things they do after they get back is to rebuild the temple. And then the next big empire on the scene, about 336-ish, I think, Alexander the Great and his gang comes in. Then there's a couple other Greek dynasties called the Seleucids and the Ptolemies. And then in the 63 BC, Pompey comes in, conquers Jerusalem, and Roman rule begins. And then about 5 BC, we have the birth of Jesus. He dies about 30 AD. Paul allegedly dies around 65 AD. That's the supposed date. And that is your entire Bible timeline. Any questions? We skipped over a lot of stuff. Okay, well, how did the Bible come together? This is where the Mormons have it all over regular Christians, because they had like a book that dropped out of heaven, and which no one saw, but except for Joseph Smith and his decoder spectacles looking into the head. We don't have, and here I want to focus more on the New Testament for a variety of reasons, partly because we're limited on time, but really the New Testament canon, when I use the word canon, are you guys okay on that? Not a gun, it's a list of books. The New Testament canon comes together actually before the Old Testament canon was decided, and we can talk about that later if you want. But when the New Testament comes together, there are no... Okay, there was nobody sat down to write the New Testament. We got that right. All different authors, books written all over the place. It came together slowly under a gradual consensus. You cannot, you can go to Washington, D.C., and you can go see, the Constitution. Okay? There's nowhere in the world where you can go and see the Bible. There's nowhere you can go in the world and see the original copy of any book of the Bible. There's no place you can go in the world and see even a shred of a fragment of an original manuscript of any book of the Bible. This book, this is the standard Greek New Testament from which every English translation is translated. There are no alternate, this is the Greek text. Was put together by scholars on the basis of about 5,000 New Testament Greek manuscripts and shreds of manuscripts. And when I say shreds, we're talking about very delicate little pieces of paper that have to be held with tweezers in hermetically sealed conditions, or else they're gonna fall apart. So every single verse of the Greek text from which every English Bible is translated is in question. You can go up and look at my Greek Bible later if you want. At the bottom of the page, you see the text up here? Okay, and down here, there's tiny, tiny, tiny little writing. Each little character there, you'll see alphas and betas, and you're going to see numbers. Every little thing down here references another New Testament Greek manuscript that has a variant reading on the verse referred to up here. So that every single, are you following me with this? I mean, this is like jaw dropping. Every single verse is was a consensus of a committee of scholars. Well, what do you think ought to go in here? I don't know. I can hardly read this sucker, It's and so it's like every single verse in the Greek, in the standard Greek text, is like their best guess at what this probably would have been. 5,000 existing manuscripts.
Mike,
yeah.
When was that done? All put together.
When did the Council of Nicaea?
Good questions. Let's cover that right now. This, and I'm not being flippant here. I have to look and see when this in the Nestle text was put together. Okay, first Nestle text was 1898, but it's been revised. And this version was 1979. And it's revised on the basis of what? Discovery of new manuscripts. The first Bible not in Latin that depended upon at least a few Greek manuscripts was a Bible put together by Erasmus of Rotterdam in the early 1500s. That's the very first time that, before that, there's a Bible, a translation by St. Jerome, long, long time ago, called the Vulgate, that became the standard. The Vulgate is still hugely important to the Roman Catholics. It's like the Latin Bible. So when did the books, actually the very first person, the very first Christian to suggest that there ought to be some kind of a New Testament or a New Testament canon, there's a guy named Marcion who lived, I want to say 150-ish. Marcion, also called Martian, interestingly, was a bishop in Asia Minor. And he said we really need to have, you know, some kind of a Bible for Christians. And so he only accepted the Gospel of Luke, some of the letters of Paul, and that was it. He rejected the entire Old Testament. Marcion was hugely influential. As late as the 500s, we have a letter from a Christian bishop warning other Christians to be careful of not going to Marcionite churches when they're traveling. Okay? This is someday I would love to do like a little mini class like this on like early Christianities. There's this myth that there was like some true church at some point. And so many Christian churches are based on this myth, you know, like the Roman church. On this rock I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. You know, I give you Peter the keys of the kingdom. That's bogus. There was never one true church. There are always as many different denominations as you see out there today. That's as many as there were almost from the get-go. Marcion was one who was hugely influential. He eventually lost out to what we call now mainline Christianity, but his folks were around for centuries. But partly because of Marcion, then the other Christians said, yeah, well, we need a New Testament because Marcion's New Testament is so crappy, so we got to come up with something. And so really by the mid-300s is when we have a consensus pretty much built around the 27 books that are currently in the New Testament. That's how long it took. More than 300 years after Jesus was born for a New Testament to come together. That's how long it took. The first reference we have, written down of the current list of books was 367 and something written by Athanasius, a bishop in Alexandria. But it wasn't ratified until 390-something at the Council of Carthage. So as someone mentioned Nicaea? Council of Nicaea was 325 AD. The issue of the New Testament was not at stake at Nicaea, and that's a good one to know, because I've often heard people say that. Nicaea had nothing to do with the content of the New Testament. What was the big deal at Nicaea? This is kind of interesting. The Arian heresies, yes. Which is interesting. Arian, another bishop from Asia Minor, Arius, I should say, taught that, you're not going to believe this. This doesn't have anything to do with the Bible, but not much of Christianity does. Yeah, I've been repressed for so long. You know, bear with me. It really doesn't. That was the thing that really started tipping the scales for me, was understanding how little was there. This is the tip of the iceberg. I mean, we're giving you the Reader's Digest version tonight. I was going to tell you about Arius. Okay, Arius, it's interesting. Someone in the back talked about the Arian heresy. Well, it's interesting because at the time of the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD, Arius's views about the nature of Christ were not the minority. They were the majority. Arius taught that, because everyone was trying to figure out if Jesus was, if he was divine, how was he divine? Because he was a human. That's a big problem. How can he be human and God at the same time? And they went around and around and around, and they philosophized and they argued about how to describe what this was. Arius' solution was that Jesus was of similar, homoi, ousios, substance, being. That Arius was of similar substance with the Father, but not identical to the Father. And the majority of Christians in 325 AD thought that he was divine, but only not totally identical to the Father. The other position, championed by people like Athanasius, who I referred to earlier, hugely influential guy, was that no, Jesus was homoousios, of the same substance or same being with the Father. People thought about this for like 100 years. And it was nasty. There's one snippet from a ancient history book describing a scene at a barber shop in Alexandria, Egypt, and the barber was of the Homoousios faction, and he, during the midst of cutting his customer's hair, found out that he was of the Homoousios faction, and he threw down his shears and walked away and wouldn't finish cutting his hair. Yeah, have you heard the phrase, down to the last iota? That's where it comes from. Oh, only one letter I separates those two positions. Iota, iota in Greek. So what happens, though, is that even though the Arian position, the similar in substance, Homoousios, was the majority view in Christianity in 325 AD, because of political shenanigans at the Council of Nicaea, this position won out. Arius was declared a heretic all over one letter I. And all mainstream Christian churches today, from Roman Catholic to Pentecostal, have this position. Based on what? Okay. Yeah.
Mike, can you say those two words again?
Homoousios, homoousios. Ousios is being or substance. Similar, same. Okay. I don't know why I went on that little rant. Well, let's talk a little bit about, okay, you all know that there are other books out there floating around, right? So how do the books that get into the Bible get into the Bible? There were, this is a gross oversimplification, but this will do for tonight, and this will get you in the ballpark. Generally, there were three main criteria. Was the book Catholic? That means, not Roman Catholic, it means universal. That means, was it read, because there were Christians, the entire Mediterranean is Christian in the year 300 AD. North Africa, Italy, Greece, Asia Minor, what we call Turkey today. So there would be some writings that were used by the churches in Asia Minor, but maybe not by the churches in North Africa. So in order for a book to make it into the canon, had to have been universally read. Was it apostolic? And authorship, that is, could we trace the authorship back to an apostle? Bear in mind that, not by our standards today, but did someone say that it was written by, like, John or Paul or whoever? And then finally, was it orthodox? That is, did it teach the so-called orthodox faith? That is, it's not going to teach an Arian position about Jesus, for example. So there's a lot of other books at the time that were written. I mean, you've heard about the Gnostic Gospels. Some of you have. And if we have time later, we get into Gnosticism, what that was about. But okay, the four Gospels in the New Testament are what? Four Gospels in the New Testament? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There's also a Gospel of Peter. There's a Gospel of Mary. There's a Gospel of James. Why didn't they make it in? There are other books. Well, there's a reason why. We can tell you later if you want. There are other books. There's a book. This one is interesting. You should look this one up. The text is available online for free. You can find it any number of places. Very, very fascinating book, the Didache, which goes back to, we think, the mid-second century. Didache means the teaching. It's a Greek word for teaching. It's often called the teaching of the apostles. The Didache is fascinating because it's one of the earliest glimpses we have of kind of Christian life and how they worship. The earliest written Christian catechism is the Didache. Was it Catholic? Yes. The Didache was used everywhere. Was it Orthodox? Yes. Apostolic? They couldn't trace the authorship. It wasn't attributed to any single apostle. So the Didache did not make it in. Anyway, there's a whole world of extra biblical literature from that time. You can, if you're interested, I encourage you to look it up. It's fascinating. But these are the reasons we got the books that we got. Revelation, which is one a lot of people really fixated on, was the last book to make the cut. It was very controversial. There are a lot of people that, I think I lost by like two votes. I don't know, making that up. but a lot of people didn't want it in. In fact, there are some Eastern Orthodox churches that still do not include Revelation in the New Testament canon. I think a lot of lives would have been saved over history if Revelation hadn't made it in. So that's a brief. Now let's talk briefly about the Gospels. And we make a distinction between. Okay, we have Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and these are called. Anyone know what these are called?
Synoptic
Gospels, which comes from the Greek word meaning to see something the same way. They see things. They see the life of Jesus pretty similar trajectory in terms of major life events happening in the same order. And then down here we have the Gospel of John, which is like way off in left field. Jesus looks like a different creature. He's a different beast than John, and he is up there. So John isn't considered one of the synoptics. Now, anyone know about the ordering of these books? When were they written? Who was the earliest book written?
Mark.
Written about when? Roughly 70, we're thinking. Bear in mind, and this is something Vic reminded me to tell you, we have no fragments going back to 70 AD. This is academic, these are biblical scholars making their best guess based on internal evidence in the text as to when these books were written. Luke and Mark probably written roughly the same time, but some people give the edge to Matthew being written before Luke. So they're written over a decade after Mark, and then John is written sometime in the 90s. And so these books, and we should have said the word gospel comes from the Greek word euangelion, which means good tidings. They tell the story of the life of Jesus. And then we have Paul's letters. We have the book of Acts. I won't get into that now. We have Paul's letters, which are all letters that he wrote to early Christian congregations, which all predate this stuff. Anyone know the earliest authorship of any book in the New Testament?
Yeah.
Were you here last time? First Thessalonians, earliest book. And that's like roughly 49 AD. So if we have Paul's letters are written between 50 and 60 AD, why do the Gospels go first in the New Testament? Any ideas?
They're given the story.
Huh?
They're given the story.
The beginning of the story, that's a charitable way of doing it. Yeah, that's a charitable way of putting it. You're a nice guy. My theory is they put, even though Paul's letters predate the Gospels by like a lot, they didn't put Paul's letters first because they didn't want anybody getting the bright idea that Paul concocted the whole thing. Which he mostly did. And I have some evidence to show you a little bit later, perhaps, to that extent. But even within the Gospels, Matthew comes before Mark, and Mark is by far the earliest. I mean, if you want to get back to the historic Jesus, Mark is one of your best places to go for any kind of evidence at all. Why didn't they put Mark before Matthew? Because I think, this is my theory, is that Mark, because it is actually closer in time to this life of the historical Jesus, and there might have been some people alive when Mark was written who kind of remember Jesus, might have been more accurate. And if you just read the Gospel of Mark, Jesus ain't such a nice guy. I mean, you can read the Gospel of Mark in about 35 minutes. Try to go back and read Mark, forgetting everything else anybody ever told you about Jesus. Like, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, and all this kind of stuff. Just read the Gospel of Mark. Okay, number one, everybody thinks of Jesus as a loving guy, right? At least we can agree on that. But if you read Mark, the word love in the entire Gospel appears exactly one time. Jesus doesn't say he loves anybody. He doesn't say that God loves you. He doesn't say that he loves you. He doesn't walk with you and talk with you or anything like that in the Gospel of Mark. In fact, what we get in Mark is stuff like this. If your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It's better to enter a kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell. That's what he sounds like. He's like pretty pissy all through Mark. He really is. He's like, you know.
Maybe he just had a
He curses a fig tree. On the following day, when they came to Bethany, he was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree and leaf, he went to see whether perhaps it would find anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. He said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And the disciples heard him.
Now, Westboro's got this backwards.
Yeah, they missed by one letter.
Yeah, and the deal is now, a whole industry of biblical scholars and theologians over 2,000 years have come up with very compelling and interesting
excuses.
Thank you. My beer's wearing off. For the you know, for verses like that. Well, he was speaking figuratively. You know, blessed are the cheesemakers. Well, no, all makers of dairy products, right? You know, he was speaking figuratively because Old Testament prophets often portrayed, when they were angry at Israel, portrayed Israel as a fig tree that wasn't producing and this kind of thing. No, because if you read throughout Mark, Jesus is like hungry all the time. In the Gospels, Jesus is like, I even said this when I was a pastor. I said, when you read the Gospels, Jesus is either finishing a meal, on his way to a meal, or in the middle of a meal. I mean, this guy might have been huge for all we know. He might have been like Chef Paul Prudhomme, the Cajun chef, you know. Maybe that's why he needed 12 disciples to carry him around, you know. I don't know. But why, I mean, there's, maybe he was just hungry and got mad at the fig tree. Maybe it's as simple as that.
Read the Gospel of Mary, he had other appetites as well.
Yes, sir. Yeah. All over the place. So, so I think the reason Matthew comes first is that Matthew and Luke are spin jobs of Mark. Because they look at Mark and it's like, this ain't going to fly if Mark's the only one we got. So we got and you read Luke. I was a Luke guy. I love Luke. I mean, Jesus cares for the poor in Luke. It's, you know, social justice, lots of, you know, forgiveness and love and all that. There's none of that in Mark. And then by the time you get to John, it's like he's the figure of Jesus in John sounds nothing at all. And I think this is really where questions started for me a long time ago. I was like, why didn't he sound anything? I mean, this is. The night before Jesus dies, just listen to this dialogue. It's not a dialogue. There's pages and pages and pages of a monologue from Jesus on the night before he dies. And this is Jesus praying in the garden. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." Now, wait a second. He's allegedly talking to his father in prayer, and he has to call himself by his full name.
Right.
And he's having this internal, you know, prayer discussion with the Lord. And how are they writing? This goes on and on and on. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work. That'd be like if I went home tonight and went and saw my dad and said, "Hi, Dad, I'm your son, Robert Michael." And, you know.
Just one question.
Yeah.
According to the Trinity, who is Jesus praying to this whole time? Because.
Yeah. Why would he be requiring marriage? This gets into our next portion of the evening, which is problems in the. Yeah, let's talk about the Trinity. We're going to talk about it later. We can talk about it now. Trinity is not anywhere found in the Bible. The only time you see like the formula that's referred to the Trinity is in Matthew chapter 28. Jesus, before he gets sucked up into heaven or does whatever he does, his final command to his disciples is, "Go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them all that I have commanded, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." That's the only time those three terms appear together, that kind of Trinitarian formula, anywhere in the Bible. Of course, we think they're put in a little bit later, and Jesus didn't utter them. There is no doctrine of the Trinity in the Bible. But the way it is, it kind of goes like this, and I'm not crazy. This is the way it is. So who was he talking to in the garden? The doctrine says that there are three distinct beings in the Godhead who somehow retain their individuality, but they are also all simultaneously one God. That's it. So,
thank you so much.
So, you know, the way I was taught in, you know, confirmation class, well, you know, Jesus is God, the Holy Spirit is God, the Father is God, but the Father is not the Spirit, and the Spirit is not the Son, and the Son is not the Father. They were three and one simultaneously at the same time. Now, why did that come about? I think it came about because you had these early Jesus followers proclaiming the divinity of Jesus, but Judaism is a strictly monotheistic religion. Like, now they weren't always, we didn't have time to get into that history tonight, but that would be a total deal breaker to have more than one God. So how do you reconcile the fact that you think that Jesus was divine, and yet there's still only one God? I mean, that's every Jewish Sabbath service includes this phrase, Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. That's the closest thing Judaism has to a creed. And it's said at every Jewish worship service, whether it's Reformed, Conservative, Orthodox. So how do you reconcile the fact that, well, you know, the belief that Jesus is divine with the strong monotheism of Judaism? Plus, you have to appeal to the Greco-Roman crowd, because they have no problem with lots of gods. They're down with that. So I think, I mean, yeah, I mean, that's the world they... this is a book I thoroughly recommend. It's a history book by a Cambridge historian, which sounds dry. I guarantee you this book is not dry at all. So, dude, it's called A World Full of Gods. And I forgot the author's name. Anyone remember the author's name? It's the best introduction to the religious world of first century Greco-Roman life I've ever seen. Fascinating book. It reads like a novel, and it's good history. A World Full of Gods. That's the world that Christianity grew up in. You had to appeal to the Jews. Because bear in mind, most Jews at this time didn't live in what we would call Israel. Where'd they live? All over the place. You had huge Jewish populations in Alexandria, Egypt, in Rome, in Babylon, in modern-day Iraq. So the Jews were all over the place, and Jews primarily spoke what language? Greek. Most Jews, by the time Jesus was alive, they weren't speaking Hebrew. Hebrew was a dead language. By the time Jesus and his gang spoke what? Aramaic, which is like, Aramaic is to Hebrew kind of like what Italian is to Latin. And so you have Jews living in the Greek world. There's all this intermingling with Greek philosophy. And so I think the Trinity was an attempt to blend together the Greco-Roman proclivity for polytheism with the Jewish insistence on a rigid monotheism. And I think that was the compromise. I think this all came together. Is that going to help? Okay. Now Trinity has become the deal. I mean, it's another central defining characteristic of the Christian doctrine of God, from Roman Catholics to Pentecostals and everybody in between, and it's not found in the Scripture. Okay, and that's, of course, one of the big beefs that especially the evangelicals have with Romney and the Mormons. It's because the Mormons say that they're three different dudes.
And they all put like a deistic, I don't know what word I'm looking for, but Jesus isn't a god. He's just the Son of God.
It's even better than that. Yeah, we can all be gods.
Yeah, but they don't pray to Jesus. They just pray.
I'm God. You can be God too.
Okay, yeah.
So it's not a polytheistic. It's like, like Zeus and
then
his one son.
Yeah. Well, okay, and this gets back to, that brought up another Trinitarian deal that just, drag. It'll come back to me. I had a really good Trinity factoid that was going to make you laugh, but maybe I shouldn't have had this in here. Okay. Is that enough on kind of roughly how the Bible came together? At least you know enough now to, you know, assure your friends that it didn't drop down from heaven and there is no original Bible. Let me do the handouts now, and we'll move into Q&A. There you go. Okay, so just real quickly, Genesis, you got... okay, here's the thing about... I forgot to tell you about the Torah, the Old Testament. I'm sorry. We think, the scholars have thought for at least since the mid-1800s, through careful analysis of the text, that there are at least four main sources for what we call the Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament. You have J, because this guy consistently refers to Yahweh. And the reason is J is because it's from German, the German version of Yahweh. The other guy is the author who consistently refers to God as Elohim. Then we have the Deuteronomist. I won't spell it out. And then we have someone called the priestly writer. Suffice it to say, for tonight's purposes, Yahweh is a merger god between a northern Israelite god named Yah and a southern one named El. I'm sorry, it's vice versa. El in the north, Yah in the south. He's a merger deity of two ancient Canaanite tribes. That's how we get him with Yahweh. And so that's why in the Old Testament, we have two versions of a lot of stuff. Because when they finally edited the Old Testament, probably sometime, a lot of the Torah done during the time of Hezekiah and Josiah, before the Babylonian exile, you have two creation accounts that have, both in Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, that have the order of creation completely different. Well, why do you have two different creation accounts in the Old Testament? Because one was from Yah, one was from El. And you can even see the differences in the Bible. Yah is very anthropomorphic. He gets angry and jealous, and he's not omniscient, because after Adam and Eve eat the apple, he has to come to the garden and say, "Adam, Adam, where are you?" An omniscient God wouldn't have to ask where Adam is. You'll see that the way God is portrayed differently. Anyway, you can look that stuff up, but that's why we have two versions of a lot of things. When you get to the story of Noah and the flood, the two versions are interwoven with each other, because there's two different accounts of how many animals. We don't think that he's supposed to take two, a male and female of every kind of animal. But actually, there's two different. The original command was to take seven pairs of all the clean animals and just one pair of all the unclean animals. Both accounts are intertwined there. So anyway, you can read through. Oh yeah, I like this one. When Joseph is sold into slavery, the slavers are on a caravan of camels. Camels weren't domesticated, we know, for 1,000 years later. So it's an anachronism in the text. Let's jump up to the New Testament. There's two genealogies of Jesus, and one in Matthew, one in Luke. I'd love to tell you about Matthew. If we have time, we'll do it later. They're completely different. And like it says here, there's two different fathers. I mean, you'd think they get the father correct. Yeah.
Well,
the father of Jesus.
I never understood why they were concerned about the line of the father of Jesus, because he wasn't the father anyway. It was Yahweh.
You're being logical.
And while we're on that, I mean, we're tracing the genealogy there, and like, I don't know if they didn't go into Mary's genealogy.
Yeah, one of them. Yeah, Mary's. They go in. I think it's Matthew's. This is through Mary's genealogy.
But I mean, it doesn't matter at all when you're discerning who's the king. It doesn't get passed down from mother to son.
Isn't Judaism matrilineal?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
It matters whether it's your
mother. But she was the daughter of the son of the son
right,
of the son of.
Right.
So it was patrilineal all the way down to generations.
Well, the thing that gets me about it, even thinking about that, like, this takes his genealogy back to, well, one of the genealogies takes him back to Abraham, the other one takes him back to Adam. I mean, anyone here do family history? How far back can you go? Does anyone, I mean, nobody alive on the planet today can trace their own lineage back 1,000 years?
Mormons can.
1,000 years?
I've seen their things. They're proudly displayed.
A thousand years?
Yeah.
That's idiotic. I'm sorry. That's God. I have an uncle who's a hardcore genealogist of the family. He's versed everything. He's gotten it back, you know, 1600s maybe. I mean, that's normal. Yeah. Well, you know it's bogus, so.
Yeah, because my grandfather did genealogy my family before he died. He could only get until when they came to America.
Right.
Before then, you know, his family, it's not enough records, not enough.
When you do the genealogy merit badge in Boy Scouts, it filled out the chart. You know, it goes back to your. They let you get a merit badge for great great grandfather, you know? Anyway, genealogy. Birth narratives in Matthew and Luke are entirely different. Can't be right. So the Christmas story that we think of. Oh, this is okay. America gets all its biblical knowledge. I said from the Ten Commandments, and it dawned on me also from the Charlie Brown Christmas special. So they get the Old Testament from Charlton Heston, and they get the New Testament from Charlie Brown Snoopy. That's right. So the Christmas story that we all know and love is a conflation of those two stories. Two different versions of the Lord's Prayer, and they're pretty different versions in Matthew and Luke. For something that important, you'd think there'd be a little bit, you know. Jesus cleansing the temple. When he goes in and challenges the temple authorities and turns over the tables of the money changers, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the synoptic gospels, he cleanses the temple at the end of his ministry. In the Gospel of John, he cleanses the temple at the beginning of his ministry. That's
maybe
huge.
Maybe he did it twice.
Hmm?
Maybe he did it twice.
That is the standard response of biblical literalists. Well, he did it twice. That's kind of like blowing up the White House twice. The temple was that important in the life of the ancient Jews. There's no way. It's one of the things that got Jesus killed. There's no way he could have done it twice. This is a famous verse. Mark chapter 13. Bear with me. This is a famous apocalyptic prophecy from Jesus, where this is towards the end of Mark chapter 13. Bear in mind the earliest of the Gospels, so most people think the most accurate in terms of portrayal of what Jesus may have said. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will be falling from heaven, the powers in heavens will be shaken. They will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. He will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. And then Jesus finishes this prophecy by saying, truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. So an apocalyptic prediction of the end of the world, and he says, people listening to this, this generation will not pass away until these words come true. Hence the legend of the wandering Jew. Are you familiar with that?
Yeah.
According to medieval legend, there's some poor Jewish guy roaming the earth since the time of Jesus, not allowed to die until Jesus comes again in order that this prophecy might be fulfilled, to keep someone from that generation alive.
That's your last prayer.
Yeah. One of my, one of the things that really, if you can jump over to the last page, you can read some of this other stuff on your own, but some of the things that really, really got to me was that if you jump over, well, like Paul's letters, as we said, are the earliest Christian writings we have. Paul, hugely, you know, significant in forming and guiding the early Christian movement. Paul does not mention Jesus' teachings, his miracles, his sayings, his birth in Bethlehem, a virgin birth, does not mention an empty tomb, does not mention a stone rolled away from a tomb. In fact, if we only had Paul to go on, it makes it sound like the whole experience of the risen Jesus is a total head trip. Like there was no visible, no touching a tangible body, Thomas touched the wounds in my side, and that kind of thing. None of that in the founding apostle. That is just, even in places,
in Paul's writing where it would have been advantageous for him to quote the boss. He doesn't. Why? It wasn't there. Now, if you go back and look at the end of Romans, like Romans 13, 14, 15, there's lists of moral exhortations, large chunks of which sound suspiciously like the Sermon on the Mount, but he doesn't give Jesus credit. I think the Sermon on the Mount came from Paul's teachings and were retroactively put into Jesus' mouth. Because why wouldn't he just? And then with a real, I came from a tradition where like Holy Communion was really important, like the Mass, the Eucharist, if you're from the Catholic or Orthodox or High Church traditions. And I started putting two and two together because the earliest reference we have to Holy Communion is in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and it comes from Paul. Now, nowhere in the Bible was it ever claimed that Paul was at the Last Supper. And just to make sure you guys understand, some of you might not know that Paul was not one of the 12 disciples. He was someone who converted to Christianity after the death and resurrection of Jesus. So he was not at the Last Supper. And yet the earliest description of the Last Supper we have is in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where he says, talking to the congregation in Corinth, "For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" Anyone here from a former Catholic, do those words sound familiar?
Very.
Like every day. I mean, this is, the Roman Catholic Church literally believes it is the perpetual sacrifice of the Mass enacted on the altar that literally keeps the earth spinning on its axis. That's hardly an exaggeration. Daily Mass,
and Episcopalians.
And Episcopalians, and some Lutherans, and a lot of Eastern Orthodox. But when I read this, did you hear? Okay, Paul wasn't at the Last Supper. Where did he say he got these words? Yeah, I received them from the Lord. Which reminds me of a text my brother sent me shortly before I started my thing tonight, which I think you guys will like. I'm going to have to bleep out part of it. This was a tweet from a guy named Danny Zucker. I'm not sure who he is. "I'm cool that God doesn't talk directly to me. I just wish he'd stop talking so many total..." Paul made up the Mass. Now, not entirely. I think he made up the words, what we call the words of institution. But the other thing, we talked about how the Trinity was a merger between monotheistic Judaism and polytheistic, Greco-Romans. I think communion is the same type of deal where you have elements of the Passover, a ritual meal of sharing, which you find all over the world. And any culture has its meal of ritual sharing that bonds people together. And you meld that together with the sacramental meals of the Roman mystery cult. Because there are Roman mystery cults like the cult of Mithras, the cult of Apollonius
Tiana?
Name? Who?
Tiana.
Tiana, yeah. Where the consumption, the ritual consumption of the body and blood of the deity was a common element to many Roman, Greco-Roman mystery cults. And so the Christians just tacked it on. Well, from a marketing perspective, it makes absolute sense. When you're trying to reach this massive Greco-Roman world out there and sell your new religious product, you're going to make it more appealing, right? Make it more palatable. Yeah, let's tack on the God-eating thing. It's fine. Now, but the plot thickens. Because I told you, and I'm going to shut up after this. John chapter 6, I told you, out of the four Gospels, John was written way later. Way later. I mean, think about it, gang. If Jesus died, let's say 30 AD, and Mark is written 70 AD, our earliest Gospel, the first things that we have written down about Jesus 40 years after the fact? I mean, I'm getting old. I know what it's like to try to remember stuff. And remember large chunks of dialogue accurately?
And then you talk about Matthew and Luke, you're getting 50, 60 years after the fact, and John. And in John, where Jesus doesn't sound anything at all like the guy he is in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, he says this. Bear with me, because every quote from Jesus in John is verbose. And he goes on and on. So Jesus said to them, talking to, well, the disciples and the crowds, "Truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life." This makes me think that the audience that John is writing to are Greco-Romans who are into the whole God-eating thing. "For my flesh is true food and my blood is true drink. And those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, whoever eats me will live because of me." Don't snicker. Okay, now wait a second. Jesus is going on and on and on about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. But Jesus is of what religion? A Jew. And if he was anything, he was an observant Jew, following the 613 commandments given to Charlton Heston. Not to mention all those dietary rules that are part of those commandments, right? And one of the foundational dietary prohibitions given to Moses in the Sinai Peninsula, in Leviticus chapter 7 and Leviticus 17, is you shall consume no blood. An observant Jew never in a million years would have advocated the eating of blood, much less his own. It makes no sense. Questions?
Along the lines of the early converts to Christianity, I know a good percentage of them tend to be the lower classes, the women, and things like that. Do we didn't have any information on like what sort of the religious beliefs are the ones that were more likely to convert versus others? Or
yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. It's a perfect question. I'm going to give another book title. I like this guy a lot. I think he might be a Christian, but it's okay. His stuff is really good. He approaches ancient origins of Christianity from the he's a modern day like sociologist. Rodney Stark. The Rise of Christianity, maybe. He has another one called Cities of God. I think it was The Rise of Christianity. Very readable, accessible books where he talks about a lot of this. The evidence, even within the biblical text itself, is that Paul, when he traveled, because you know Paul traveled around the Mediterranean trying to plant Christian congregations, and the evidence was he didn't have a lot of success with the local Jewish groups. He had some. Christianity started out as a branch of Judaism. They saw themselves as a fulfillment of the promises of the Old Testament, but very quickly, found a niche among the Greco-Roman pagan world. The other thing too is there's this myth of like explosive growth of the early church. Rodney Stark puts that to rest. He shows that the growth was not like exponential or anything out of the ordinary for any successful social movement. So highly recommend the books of Rodney Stark to give you a real good sense of that. They're all different backgrounds. And I think there's evidence. Some of you guys might know this better. Who was the Egyptian goddess who they're like the whole worship of this one Egyptian goddess was a lot like Mary worship, and we think was that Isis?
It was Isis.
Yeah.
Horus.
Because
if you look at the story of Horus,
yeah,
it's Jesus' story,
exactly,
just with a different name.
Yeah.
I mean, it's set before.
Yeah. So you see the influences. I found out that there were stories that I loved that Jesus told that I thought were Jesus stories. And I find out later that now they got other like versions of these stories were floating around before, you know, written down in pagan sources before Jesus, you know, said them. So that was a bummer. There's a question there, and then Donald.
Is there any outside sources that talk about, like, you know, like after the birth of Jesus, the killing of all the young children that were...
Oh, exactly. No, there is no no source outside the Bible, no extra biblical source regarding the slaughter of the innocents at all. None. None whatsoever. Yeah, that's another problem. Donald.
Three questions. The first one would be in regards to how Acts is such a validation of Paul. It kind of puts Paul in the midst of everything. So understanding the background of Acts is probably significant. Also, the book of Hebrews, which is a real controversy in terms of who the actual authors are.
Oh.
Right.
We don't know.
Yeah.
We don't know. Long time ago, it was considered one of the Pauline epistles, but no credible Bible scholar today believes that Paul wrote it, and we don't know who did. Maybe we know very little about who wrote Hebrews, although it does seem to be written, I mean, because of the emphasis on the high priest, on Jesus playing his priestly role. Now, we're thinking to a Jewish Christian community primarily. Probably. Can I say something about Acts real quick, though?
Yeah.
Because I think it's one of the things I put on your sheet is to check out how the story of Paul's... Donald's right. The whole second half of Acts is all about Paul. I mean, it's like the heroic travels of Paul. The conversion of Paul in Acts is a different story than Paul's own account of his own conversion in Galatians chapter 1. And there are things that cannot be resolved there. So that's also on your sheet, and I gave you the verses to reference.
Yeah, I have one other thing.
Sure.
That I think is kind of interesting. And this really applies to our culture and the way that we've been somewhat indoctrinated from a Judeo-Christian perspective. And this even applies to atheists, because we've been convinced that Islam is the worst of all of them.
Yeah.
And so we tend to not even want to talk about it. So the idea of, in this conversation, it didn't come up. But what's interesting here is that within the story of Abrahamic religions, the story of Ishmael is important.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's where it comes from.
Yeah.
Now, but what takes place within the concept of how these religions have developed, Judaism begins its own power struggle. And then Christianity says, well, we're going to be better than you guys. So the way we're going to be better is that we're going to be right there next to God. So everybody else is just going to fall up under us. So it kind of leaves Islam over there by itself from the standpoint of its comparison to Christianity and Judaism. So
yeah.
So I think it's interesting that we have this tendency not to want to understand their religion.
Yeah.
And so, but I think it's very significant.
I think it's very significant too, Donald. One reason I didn't get into that tonight, just because my background is the Bible, and I can't speak with authority on the Quran. I mean, I've spent 20 years preaching on the Bible week after week, and so I know it. But I think it was a really important reminder, because this was another eye-opening thing for me, probably for you too, is how when I came to understand that kind of the evolutionary roots of human religious experience, how it's like any other human behavior, it's developed along a continuum, and that Judaism was not a radical break from the Canaanite religions like it's portrayed, and rather it came out of it. I mean, the ancient Jews were Canaanites, and the transition to monotheism wasn't like this. It was many, many centuries, so it's this unbroken line from hunter-gatherer prehistoric religion to the religion of the ancient agrarian settlements in Mesopotamia, Canaanite religion, Judaism, Christianity flows out of that, Mormonism evolves out of that, Islam evolves out of that same deal, and it's all, like everything else we experience in life, everything is in a constant state of morphing all the time. And it wasn't this distinct, you know, lightning bolt from heaven that established, you know, no one ever, okay, now I'm trying to think too, it's like, why is monotheism better than polytheism? I guess I never questioned that. I was always taught that as a kid. Oh, you know, monotheism was a big step over polytheism. It's like,
What's the difference?
Right.
You know? Isn't it better to have more, you know?
Well, considering that God, according to the Bible, God says that Israel is going to be a powerful nation also. So, where is that nation?
I think that all the historical stuff in the Bible was written. The tale of Abraham didn't exist. Moses, I'm going to say it to the camera, Moses didn't exist.
Wait, Charleston Heston didn't exist.
Yeah.
Charlton Heston definitely existed. I saw him.
Oh, yeah, you saw him. Yeah, that's the problem, yeah. But you hear what I'm saying, is that these were mythical tales of national formation written by later administrations to lend credence and support to... Much of the story of King David, for example, was leveraged by a guy named King Josiah, who was the king right before the Babylonian exile. Almost all of that stuff was written to retroactively justify the policies of the administration on the ground at the time. And the Ishmael thing is part of that, too. So, and we could, I mean, the whole, talking about the origins of Islam would be another fascinating. There's some, I think, current thinking, some of you guys might know more about this than I do, is that the Islam emerged out of one of those ancient forms of Christianity that was one of the minority positions, the Monophysites, who rejected the Trinitarian stuff that was happening in Constantinople. And it happened to be in the more Arab sections of the Byzantine Empire. And when they broke away from the Byzantine Empire, they took their Monophysite tendencies with them and concocted a religion that would glorify the Arabian Peninsula. I think it's highly likely.
Yeah. Oh, I was just adding on something. What I've noticed in my experience is when I started reading about other religions, especially Mithras or Islam and all that, was it's always tend to be whitewashed, as in the case of Islam, it's, well, they just copied off the Christians. You know, or when I talk about Buddhism, for example, I say, well, here's an example of a man who taught exactly the same things Jesus taught 500 years before Christ in another part of the world, and it was, oh, well, you know, that's a false religion. It's got a snugget of the truth, but it's still a false religion. That's just kind of one of the things I wanted to add.
Yeah, I think I love... It's just fascinating. I mean, why should we think that the ancient world was any different than the world today, where we live in a state of constant cultural cross-fertilization? Right. And, I mean, everything, you know, the cultures of the world are intertwining. And so, you know, here in Houston, we can eat, like, sushi, which when I was a kid, that wouldn't happen. You know what I mean? And so there is a Buddhist king who... a couple centuries after the Buddha lived, who probably was kind of the Paul equivalent of Buddhism in terms of lending organizational genius to the movement, who apparently sent some Buddhist emissaries as far as the areas of the world controlled by the Greeks, and was there intermingling among the predecessors of the Greeks and the Cynics, the Buddhists and the Cynics. I mean, everywhere people go, they talk to each other, and they borrow ideas. Yeah. And so I think there was massive cross-fertilization.
There was a lot of trade between ancient... And this blew my
mind. A lot of trade.
There was a lot of trade between ancient China and ancient Rome.
Yeah.
They constantly sent... China wanted Rome... Not Rome. Rome wanted silks, and China wanted, I don't know, gold. I forgot what they wanted out of Rome. But there was constant trade between the two, and I've heard... a lot of people crackpot theories of, well, that 30 years where you don't hear from Jesus, that's when he was in India studying Buddhism.
Now, John Prine has an album about that, about the missing years.
Yeah.
Don't even start on crackpot theories.
You know, a lot of this that we've talked about tonight, it's the scientific inquiry. It's the same thing you would do for the hard sciences, even though religion's a soft science.
Uh-huh.
And all that sort of stuff. So when you look at the origins of Christianity from like Constantine, who talked about the importance of faith over using your reason, to Loyola, who founded the Jesuits, talking about the first thing God demands is
Martin Luther called reason a whore.
Yes, yeah, and you have to surrender it.
Yeah.
Well,
what they've essentially done is asked people to accept all these things that they claim as a leap of faith.
Yeah.
And you abandon your reason and your logical mind to arrive at this conclusion. And the question you have to ask yourself is, what's the purpose of it? Is it simply death angst, where people have been promised immortality, and so they cling to that with their faith, and they never release it?
Yeah.
You made a point before, and legitimacy. Legitimizes whatever governs the control.
That's, yeah. I think there's huge power games at work there. I think the question you have is huge. I think a great, for me, some of the answers came from a book by Nicholas Wade called The Faith Instinct, where he gets into some of the potential evolutionary roots of human religious behavior. I think a lot of it does have to do with power games, control games. I think some of it goes way, way back before we even settled down. This is one of the eye-opening things for me, and it makes total sense, is that because Homo sapiens existed for the overwhelming bulk of its, you know, time on Earth in hunter-gatherer tribes, and we only settled down 10,000 years ago. I mean, that's nothing in geologic time, nothing in the history of our species. What is it that E.O. Wilson said in Social Conquest of the Earth, his latest book, how we've created the Star Wars civilization with Stone Age mentality and medieval institutions. I mean, that's a paraphrase. I think that is the human condition. I think the roots of religious behavior go way back, I find evolutionary psychology and paleoanthropology so compelling and understanding. Like, for example, it explains why when I'm swimming at Galveston, I scream the same way whether I'm being touched by a shark or a piece of seaweed. You know?
So I have a question. This is probably for Jason. But when you were talking about the Islamic faith, I thought the Islamic faith was a Judeo faith, that it came from the Abraham, as you said. But is it a separate?
It's out of that line. I mean, yeah, Islam recognizes all the prophets of the Old Testament as prophets. They recognize Jesus as a prophet. They have a slightly different take on some of the events in the life of Jesus. So they're in that. They're in that branch. I mean, they've evolved out of that branch. Well, all I was saying was that some of the latest thinking is that the roots of Islam actually lie in a group. Remember how I mentioned the Marcionites? I mean, there's all these different branches of early Christianity that it grew out of a branch of early Christianity called the Monophysites. And there's some very compelling evidence, archaeological evidence, to suggest that. The reason we don't have the same kind of textual discussions about the Quran that we have for the New Testament is that at some point early in the development of Islam, one of the caliphs had every manuscript of documents that went to the formation of the Quran destroyed, so they only have one Quran. We will never have the documentary evidence for the Quran like we have for the New Testament.
Don't you think it's interesting that most modern day Christians deny that it's the same God?
Oh, is it the same God? I can't answer that. I mean, historically they came out of the same tradition, but those are fighting words among Christians today.
Right.
Most Christians do not think that Muslim, they think it's a false God.
Yeah. The Arabic word, and Spanish has terms for Ohana, I pray to God.
Right, right.
But the Arabic word for God is Allah.
Yeah.
Arabic Christians and Palestinian Christians, which 40% of Palestinians are Christian. I never knew that. In college, but they refer to God. Their word for God is Allah.
Well, let me just say this about I. And now that I'm with you guys, I'm giving up trying to define what other people consider who is a legitimate God, who is not a legitimate God, because Christians can't even agree upon this among themselves. You can't have like an abstract discussion about, like, the existence of God. Like, does God, well, what God are you talking about? The God of, you know, the Roman Catholics, who really, really don't like, you know, gay people and masturbation or abortion, or the God of the evangelicals, who are really pro-military and cheesy music, or the God of the Pentecostals, or the God of the, you know, the mainline Protestant God, who kind of really cares for the poor and hurting the world, but can't get around to doing anything about them. There is no Christian definition of God. Am I right?
Right.
There's hundreds of Christian gods out there. Christians are just as polytheistic as the ancient Greco-Romans were. I don't think we need to be real about that. There is no, and when I was, even when I was a liberal mainline Protestant, when I heard what the stuff that Ed Young was saying, I'm like, I don't get how we're the same religion, you know? And then you're supposed, when you're a Christian, you're supposed to put on this whole, oh, like, we're, you know, we're brothers in Christ. Oh, bull. These are different. These are different beasts, different creatures, different gods.
Pat Robertson. And Pat Robertson's even quoted as saying, I don't have to be nice to the Episcopalians,
no.
Methodists, and
no.
Presbyterians. Fuck them.
Right.
One thing that I saw this video, and what it kind of explained, and this is why when you say you don't believe in God, people will say that you're rejecting God. It's because God, to people that are really heavily invested in it, is themselves. That's why God believes like they do.
It's a projection of your values.
It's your projection of your values onto another being.
Yeah.
That,
which is confirmation bias.
Yeah.
It's a universal human trait. We all do it. We, you know, we try to, I mean, at least, I love hanging with you guys, because more than any other group of people I've ever hung out with, we do try to think rationally. But all of us are subject to confirmation bias all the time. But at least we're aware of that. But I think you're right. Confirmation bias plays in hugely to people's projections of God. What time is it getting to be, gang? I want to watch, because I know some of you got a roll, and I don't want to. I'll be around the time. It's 8:35, so we set our run to like about 8:30. I'll hang out. Last time we hung out for like 2 hours, so I'm good for the night. I'll be glad to chat with anybody. You guys hang out. We have the room, because Vic says we have the room for the rest of the night. So I'm ready to maybe munch on something and. Rapid. I would like to end with some words of thanks. I would like to thank. Well, and Catherine's coming in the door. Our wait person tonight is in a barber's style. Thank you. Please remember her in your thoughts and in your wallets. And, okay.
Gratuity is included.
Oh, it is?
Okay.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Yeah. And then I want to thank, because I forgot to thank them last time, Vic and Sergio for their technical support on the video and the audio. I guess Vic's going to put something together and put it up on YouTube. Thank you guys for showing up on a weeknight, on a school night, on a Monday night of all nights. And getting back to the, and I said this to the gang last time, you know, getting back to how, you know, like evolutionary psychology, paleoanthropology have changed my life and the way I'm looking at the world. I'm now more cognizant than ever of how deeply ingrained. I mean, there are things written into our DNA that we can't do anything about. I don't think we have to do anything about. And one of those is that we are a deeply tribal species. Yeah, there are some people out there who are loners, but most humans need a tribe. I mean, it's the way we survived. It's the way the predecessor hominid species survived. It's wired into us. I think it's one reason, it's a powerful reason, that many people stay in religion despite their qualms about the metaphysical claims. And a lot of people, I've been hearing ever since I came out in a very public way, hearing fairly nonstop from Christians who are kind of said, yeah, I don't buy this anymore either, and we're ready for something else. I mean, I think it's huge, guys. Mm-hmm. I really do. So be patient with your Christian friends, because I think the hardest thing to do is to leave a tribe. I grew up in that tribe. It nurtured me for, you know, decades. And I could not have done it if I hadn't gone kind of randomly, because I wanted to hear some authors I wanted to, that who I've been reading, who are going to be in town for the Texas Free Thought Convention last October. And so I went incognito. Just like under, I could be under the radar. And a former parishioner of mine was at the registration desk. And she almost immediately introduced me to Vic. And I met a bunch of awesome people. And it was connected. When I saw a vision of an alternate tribe, that's when I knew I could make the move. So I just want to thank you guys for being that tribe.